Marcus Kincaid has been around for a long time, ever present with but a simple role and purpose. His background and past are largely unknown, though as seen through various portraits of his ancestors, he came from a long line of weapons dealers, 7 generations to be exact, who all look eerily similar to himself. While it's not exactly known, in the earlier days of Pandora, he had been initially allied with either Dahl and/or Atlas. It's not too important now, but those were really his only 2 customers to sell weapons to back then. After Dahl wound up leaving the planet once their failed hunt for vaults came to an end, they flooded the planet with convicts and psychos. Life on Pandora became more hostile and lawless than it already was. Being the businessman he is, Marcus saw the opportunity and seized it as he took claim to every weapons vendor that was on the planet and sold his weapons through there. Unofficially, of course. He also took on a more mercenary outlook when it came to selling his weapons. If you wanted to buy it, you could. It didn't matter who you were affiliated with, so long as you had the money, Marcus would provide you the guns. But no refunds, and nothing is free. He sold pretty much any and all weapons from every manufacturer that he could, the 2 that he hasn't being Iridian and Gearbox's special brand. While weapons are definitely his main moneymaker, he had several other jobs he took up as well. In what doesn't quite seem as the greedy mercenary type he's built himself up to be, he helps distribute supplies to the residents of Pandora. Though his generosity is of course paralleled by the fact that this also makes him money. The only hints of this having been a thing that he did was he became suspicious of Patricia Tanis, who had been surviving on her own without buying supplies from him.
We haven't had a supply transport come in years. The commerce grid shows no log of her ever using any of my trade stations. But she must be getting resupplied somehow.
Obviously, you need more than just guns to survive, and it seems that Marcus's inventory was larger than it appeared. And probably the single most important thing that he contributes, whether he's aware of it or not, he's a bus driver. Marcus is the one responsible for picking up the vault hunters and setting them off on their new journey to hunt vaults. Yet again, another job which involves making money since vault hunters need guns. So he's always looking for new customers. While in the comic line series for the game, Marcus does have a hand in the recruitment of Roland, Lilith, Mordecai, and Brick, his main motivation seems to be a classic sales pitch to get most of them to join. Roland and Brick are simply picked up, while Lilith is convinced on the promise of adventure and mystery. While Mordecai got the biggest pitch of them all, being told about how the planet needs vault hunters with the reward of money and loot. The first game starts off with each of them already on the bus. The 4 had already been recruited, so Marcus's job was done, and so he drops them off at a bus stop where the local claptrap runs them through the basic information. While they're off doing what they do, Marcus returns to business as usual. He goes on to reopen some of his vending machines in locations he thought weren't worth it since the vault hunters are clearing out the riffraff. A lot of his dialogue in the first game is dedicated to distrusting Tanis and questioning the existence of the vault. But as the game goes forward and it's more and more clear that the vault is real, he warms up next to the vault hunters for a piece of that loot. In the Zombie Island of Dr. Ned DLC, he does have the ever slightest of role in it as he hacks one of the claptraps and warns the characters not to trust Dr. Ned. The next DLC saw the introduction of Moxie. This is important because Marcus was her 3rd ex-husband. While the 2 are divorced in modern day, they are on good terms and Marcus even still thinks very highly of her. She, in fact, is the reason he looks the way he does. She told him that he should look more obese so that his enemies would underestimate him, which she was right about.
You know, I tried to be charitable once. I gave Moxie everything when we were married. You know she's why I'm fat, right? She said, Marcus, make your enemies underestimate you. If you're ruthless, look fat. If you're smart, look sexy. Bright girl. Miss her sometimes.
While he doesn't play a role in the events of Claptrap's new robot revolution, he does appear at the very end of the game where he was supposedly shot and killed. Being the narrator of the games who's recounting how everything's transpired, this part of the story was made up by Marcus so, and I quote, to keep the ladies hanging around. But that's not the only thing that happened this DLC. Despite his initial distrust of Tanis, he actually found himself going on a date with her. He sends you out to get him some cologne, but the date itself doesn't go too well, and neither does his reaction towards being rejected.
Turned me down. Me! Said I was a smelly, cretinous oaf. That batshit crazy Tanis don't know what she's missing. Ah, heartbreak makes me hungry. And only Captain Sanders' famous Pandora Fried Rack can mend a broken heart.
After the downfall of General Knox, it marked the beginning of the end to the Atlas Corporation. More importantly, the company fled Pandora and would later go on to go out of business entirely. Once this happened, yet again Marcus attempted to claim all of their leftover weaponry, but it was actually installed with brickware, making it impossible for him to sell his weapons. But fortunately, it could still be used for scrap.
After Atlas went out of business, I was the only gun runner on Pandora with a stock of their weapons. I thought it would be a gold mine, but those Atlas bastards were tricky. They installed brickware on every gun they sold. When the company went under, their weapons disabled themselves. What a waste! Oh well, at least I can always unload this junk to the bandits. Those chumps will buy anything.
If there was any friction between anyone, it was between him and Roland. Roland did not ethically agree with his business practices in selling to the enemy and pretty much anyone who could pay, but nevertheless, it didn't stop him from insisting that he move to Sanctuary because of Handsome Jack for his own safety, which he did. Despite this, though, he didn't stop selling to the Crimson Raiders' direct competition of bandits, specifically the Bloodshot Bandits. In fact, Marcus actually became a bit of an icon and god figure in their eyes. Various shrines were built in his honor, representing their loyalty to him and his services. He continued business as usual in the events of Borderlands 2, though fully capable of recognizing the danger Jack presented on the planet, but more importantly, his business. He does send you out on a few side missions to reclaim some money that's owed to him for purchasing his guns, but aside from that, he doesn't play too big of a role. A little character development does happen for him though, as in the run-up to take down Handsome Jack, he gives you a weapon for free to help stop him, the first time he's ever done this. He would later go on to be given his own dedicated headhunter pack called Marcus Saves Mercenary Day. Mercenary Day was a holiday created by Dahl where all mercenaries would provide their services for free, a concept Marcus clearly doesn't like and despises with a passion. The DLC takes place in the town of Gingerton, a very festive small town which, similar to the Bloodshots, wound up praising Marcus as some sort of folk hero. Only this time it comes from the fact that he chose not to kill everyone in their town because he lost a bet.
Stupid townsfolk around here think I'm their savior just cause I was gonna hire you to kill them, but I changed my mind at the last minute. If it hadn't been for me losing that $9 to Kai a few months back, I would have had you clear this place out.
When the town purchases guns from him for the holiday and hopes to give them to each other for free, Marcus makes his way to the town when his shipment of weapons goes missing. It turns out the whole place has been overrun by an evil snowman and frozen over. Marcus's initial instinct is to reclaim his weapons and bring them back to his shop, then unfreeze the town folk, telling them that the bandits stole the guns.
Now, convince the conductor to get the train moving. Once the guns are back in Gingerton, we can take them home before the town unfreezes. Then, we'll tell the townsfolk that bandits stole the guns, and I'll keep my money and my merchandise.
This doesn't work, however, as after being unfrozen, they notice the guns. As a begrudging gift, he decides to let the Vault Hunters kill the snowmen and save Gingerton, thus giving them a Mercenary Day miracle. And that's how Marcus saved Mercenary Day. Honestly, between the events of the games, Marcus doesn't really do too much or have any sort of story as far as we're aware. The only significant event we know of so far was that by now, Rhys Strongfork has obtained the deed to Atlas and has become the CEO. He went to Marcus offering him a business deal and partnership. However, the Atlas Marcus knew was a laughingstock and he saw no benefit in it and promptly declined.
So this guy comes into my shop today, Rhys Strongfork, says he's the new CEO of Atlas, the poor fool. Offered to get me in on the ground floor. Of what, I said? A pile of rubble, a disbanded army, a tarnished brand? I told him his business sense was worse than his fashion sense, and this was a guy who talked his necktie into his pants. He slunk away like all the rest of these get-rich-quick morons. That guy won't last one fiscal quarter. Mark Marcus's words.
Of course, this decision would prove to be an unwise one as Rhys, alongside Zero, managed to rebuild the company up to a respectable stance once more. Marcus, admitting he was wrong, called Rhys and made a partnership with him.
Well, Here's something you don't see every day. Marcus eating crow. That Reese fellow, he's got Atlas making new tech. Crazy stuff like homing bullets. Well, I know a price leader when I see one. I had to buy in while I could. I called Reese to let him know I'd reconsidered his offer. He gouged me, of course, but in the end, we made a deal. For better or worse, the Atlas I knew, the sad shadow chasing its own crimson tail, is gone.
But throughout the rest of the years, as well as his role in Borderlands 3, he just sells weapons per usual, not really impacting or doing much. And since there's no DLC with him, he's left off doing exactly what it is he does best, selling other people's guns. And theoretically, while it's not ever been confirmed yet, the furthest part of Marcus's story seems to be sometime in the future we've yet to see. Throughout all of these games, he served as the primary narrator, telling the story of what happened with the Vault Hunters and the adventures that they went on, all usually in the context of recounting these to orphans. In modern day, we don't know when or why he does this. Once again, he goes against the strong persona he's built himself up as, doing some genuinely nice things, even if it comes with an attitude.
I gotta teach somebody to tell these stories when I'm gone. Might as well be you.
Yeah. I love you, Marcus!
That's weird.
Some other fun facts about Marcus are that he has his own set of playing cards. These can be found in Treachery's Landing on the secret boat. He also keeps various pictures of Moxie in his special protection. So when they wind up elsewhere, he sends you out to reclaim them and return them to him. But for now, that does it for the history of Marcus Kincaid, always acting as an overseer whether we're aware of it or not. If there are any other characters you'd like to see me do the history of, then be sure to let me know in the comments below, and until next time, I'll see you in the next video.